Amen. That was the introduction today. All right. Number one. Amen. Here's why we must be urgent. Three things we got to be urgent about. Number one, we've got to be urgent about being spiritually prepared for His coming. We got to be ready for His coming. There's a powerful parable in Matthew chapter 25. It tells us of the five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins. And it is interesting that as far as we know from the study of Scripture, that Jesus only told this parable to those who were His disciples. This wasn't shared in an open forum like many other of the parables of Christ. And as I think about that, it reminds me that this is to be something that the church of the Lord Jesus Christ ought to look at from time to time. Do you believe that? And I want to say this today and just kind of lay a foundation today. And I'm not taking a judgmental stance against anybody, but the Scripture tells us this, that not everyone who attends church is a true Christian. That's true. Am I right? The Scripture says that the wheat grows alongside of the tares. There are people who are possessors, right? People who possess the real thing, right? You have Jesus Christ in your heart, Christ in you, the hope of glory. You know that for, I mean, come on. You can know that you know that you know with your knower. Do I got any saved people in the house? Okay, and there are people who are just professors. They just profess to be believers in Jesus. And they can go through all the motions, say all the right words, but they're really, their heart is not truly right with God. And Paul even writes this in one of his epistles. He says this. He says, examine yourself and see if you're in the faith. Those were the words of the Apostle Paul. He wrote that to believers to make certain that we would be right with the Lord. And so I want to read this parable to you today of the five wise and the five foolish virgins. Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. It's a little lengthy here today, but hold on with us, all right? It says, then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now, five of them were wise and five were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. Now, it is obvious for me, looking at this parable, that the bridegroom is Jesus Christ. Am I right? The bridegroom is the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's apparent today as we are looking at this parable in the year 2019, right, that it's pretty obvious that the coming of the bridegroom has been delayed, right? The coming of Jesus, he said, I'm coming soon, but he said that 2,000 years ago. But you see, we have to understand why he was delayed. There's a reason why he's delayed his coming, and that is because he loves humanity so much that he wants to give every conceivable possible chance that as many people as possible can come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. He only does delays because he wants more people to come in. Am I right? But when I read this parable, I see the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, because I see those who are gathering. The 10 virgins were gathering. They were waiting on the bridegroom, right? And I see those who are saying, yes, he was coming. But five are wise and five are foolish. And let's read the rest of the parable here today. Verse number 6, it says, and at midnight a cry was heard. How many of you know he's going to come whenever? It may be at midnight or noon. Somewhere on the planet it's going to be midnight. Hello. All right. But anyway, it says, behold, the bridegroom is coming, go out to meet him. And then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should not be enough for us and you, but go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, we could easily say, while they went to prepare themselves and get ready, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. And how many of you know when the Lord shuts a door, the door is shut? Come on. And it says, verse 11, and afterward the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you. And then there's this warning given. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. And the question becomes this: what made the wise virgins wise and the foolish virgins foolish? There's three things I see in this parable. You may want to jot them down. First of all, the wise made preparation and the foolish did not. Now, I'll tell you, I have a recurring dream. It sometimes hits me in the middle of the night. And I'm somewhere, and I've been asked to preach, and I'm not prepared. I don't know why I dreamed that dream, because if you know me, you know that I am prepared, all right? There's never been a Sunday I stood up here and said, well, now, let me see, what am I going to do? I'm prepared, all right? But I don't want to find myself in a position of being unprepared. How about you? That would be foolish, right? And the foolish didn't prepare. The wise person prepares. The wise are completely ready. Now, in those days, back in Jesus' days, a young woman, a virgin, would remain in her parents' house until the bridegroom came, all right? The bridegroom would come and make arrangements. The family of the bridegroom would come and make arrangements with their family, but the bridegroom would probably live in another village or somewhere else, and he would be preparing a place for his new bride, all right? And you know, it may be that he would build her a house. And how many have ever been in construction? It always takes longer than you think it would, right? So things could get delayed very easily. One thing could happen or another thing could happen. But the young woman had the responsibility and job to remain in her parents' house until the bridegroom came, and she had to get herself ready because she didn't know when he would come. And usually it was at night when the festivities began. They would come at night, and all those who would gather to go to the wedding would have to travel, and so they had to have a lamp ready, okay, to be able to make the journey. And so the point of the parable is this: that if you're going to be ready for the rapture of the church, if you're going to be ready for when the bridegroom comes, you've got to make preparation. Am I right? How many of you believe that that's the point, right? And it's not enough just to have everything outwardly prepared. You've got to be prepared in your heart. Because let me tell you something. Very soon, the bridegroom is coming, right? Very soon, the shout's going to be made. Amen. Here comes the bridegroom, right? King Jesus is coming. And I'm going to tell you something. He's going to take you and me, if you're right with the Lord, he's going to take us on a journey, right? We're going to meet him in the clouds, and then we're going to go to a place he's prepared. Jesus said this: in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And then I'm coming back, and I'm going to bring you where I am as well. And let me tell you something. Not only are we going to receive that spiritual habitation, but we're going to celebrate with the Lord in what's called the marriage supper of the Lamb. I'm just telling you, there's a lot of the word that's in here. But what I'm trying to say today is that the most important thing in any person's life is that they get themselves spiritually prepared. You don't want that day to take you unaware. You don't want that day to happen when the rapture occurs and you're not ready. Let me tell you, it's more important that you get right with God than you get your income taxes in so you can get your tax return back. It's more important that you get right with God than you clean the house, than you go to work. It's the most important thing in the world. But I'm going to tell you, there's going to be some foolish that aren't prepared on that day. They'll be left behind. Scripture tells us that. Some are taken and others are left. They're going to say this. They're going to say, well, you know what? I gathered with the church. Some will say that. They'll say, I went to church. I sang the songs. I did all those outward things. But the thing is, they never prepared themselves on the inside. How many of you know that Christianity isn't an outward religion? Come on. Amen. A lot of people think it's outward religion. Well, you dress a certain way and you talk a certain way and, you know, you say hallelujah in a certain way. No. Christianity is something that goes on the inside. Come on. The scripture says this: you've got to be born again. You must be born again. You come to God and you ask him forgiveness. You receive Jesus Christ into your life. You receive him as your Savior. You receive him as the director of your life. And I'll tell you, it's more than simply saying a little prayer. What it is, you've got to also, he doesn't just come as your Savior. He comes as King and he comes as Lord. Amen. He is the King and he is the Lord. And to be right with God, you've got to turn away from from the sinful things and turn to the living God. Come on, somebody. Amen. That means you've had a change of mind in your heart that will ultimately affect your change of the way you walk and the way that you live in this world. That's good preaching, Pastor. Amen. Amen. And you say, well, how can I know? We talked about that in class today. How can I know? How much I want to know that I'm right. Amen. Did you know that you can know that you're right? If there's any doubt in your mind, let me tell you something. I encourage you to pray about it. Because the scripture says this. It says that your spirit, that part that's on the inside of you, your spirit can bear witness with the Spirit of God, or the Spirit of God bears witness with your spirit that you're a son or a daughter of God. Come on. Is there anybody that says, I can know that I know that I know that I know, amen, that Jesus Christ is my Savior and my Lord. He knows who I am and I know who He is. Come on, give the Lord a big hand of praise. Amen. And then the scripture says this, that everyone who has this hope in Him, who's got the hope of Jesus coming? If you have that hope, it says this, in Him, whoever has that hope purifies himself just as He is pure. My wife and I were very concerned one day when we were talking with somebody, and the person said, you know, I'm going to need about 3 days, you know, before I die. You know, I just want to make sure. Man, that was a huge red flag for me and my wife especially. Amen. How many, you know, you don't want to wait till the doctor says, okay, you got 3 days left. Now, hello, how many of you say I want to be right now? Amen. Come on. Amen. Then the next thing I see here is that the wise had oil and the foolish did not. The wise had oil. And oil in the scripture is representative of the Holy Spirit. Now, how many of you realize that your lamp is not going to burn very bright if there's no oil in it, right? We are the light of the world, right? We shine our light to the world. And the Holy Spirit, what happens when you become a believer is the Holy Spirit seals you with his seal. The Holy Spirit is a part of your life, and it helps you to shine that light out. Amen. It's something that God gives. It's that oil of the Holy Spirit. It's because you've turned to Him. Amen. And let me tell you something. You know, as you read through this, it looks like that the wise virgins were very selfish. They're like, no, you can't have any of my oil. Go get money. Go get it for yours. That was not the case, right? Because they're illustrating, a parable illustrates a spiritual truth. And the truth is, as much of God as I have, as much as Jesus as I have, or you have, you can't give that to somebody else. Now, you can point them to the way. You can tell them the truth of the gospel. You can show them how to get saved. But let me tell you something. They've got to experience that power of the Spirit and regeneration on the inside for themselves. How many of you are with me today? Come on. Amen. Amen. So the question is not, well, you know, I gathered with them, and besides, my daddy was a preacher, and my aunt taught a Sunday school class. It doesn't matter what your family did. Hello? Come on. It doesn't matter how religious your family was. And let me tell you something. Do you have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus? Amen. Amen. That's the thing. Do you know the Lord? And then the third thing here that I see is that the wise were known by the Lord, but the foolish were not. It's powerful scripture here, this last one. And it's important to have a relationship with Jesus, because afterward the other virgins came also saying, Lord, Lord, open up to us. They called Him Lord. They called Jesus Lord. Lord, Lord, open to us. But He answered and said, assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you. How many know there's another scripture that talks about saying, Lord, Lord? Right? There's another scripture where the people came and Jesus said, many will say in that day, Lord, Lord. Didn't I do many things in your name? Didn't I cast out devils and heal the sick? And, you know, didn't I do wonders in your name? And Jesus is going to say these words. And I think they're the scariest words in the human language. Depart from me, I never knew you. Those are scary words. But let me tell you something. We don't have to be afraid of those words. Amen? Because we can know Him. Amen? We can know the Lord Jesus Christ. And we can know that we know that we know that we know Him. Let me tell you something. I don't need an apologist to tell me that I know Jesus. I don't need to even, I thank God for the Word of God. Come on. Are you grateful for the Word of God? But let me tell you something. I don't even need to have the Word of God, amen, to show me that I need, that I know Jesus. You want to know why? Because His Spirit lives inside of me.